It was just before the Passover feast. Jesus knew that the time had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them the full extent of his love. The evening meal was being served, and the devil had already prompted Judas Iscariot, son of Simon, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand." "No," said Peter, "you shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no part with me." "Then, Lord," Simon Peter replied, "not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well." Jesus answered, "A person who has had a bath needs only to wash his feet. His whole body is clean, and you are clean, though not every one of you." For he knew who was going to betray him, and that was why he said, "Not everyone was clean." When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. "Do you understand what I have done for you?" he asked them. "You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you." When he was gone, Jesus said, "Now is the Son of Man glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will glorify the Son in himself and will glorify him at once. My children, I will be with you only a little longer. You will look for me. And just as I told the Jews, so I tell you now, where I am going, you cannot come. A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." I love the Lord, for he heard my voice. He heard my cry for mercy.
Because he turned his ear to me, I will call on him as long as I live.
The cords of death entangled me. The anguish of the grave came upon me. I was overcome with trouble and sorrow.
Then I called on the name of the Lord. "O Lord, save me."
The Lord is gracious and righteous. Our God is full of compassion.
The Lord protects the simple hearted. When I was in great need, he saved me.
Be at rest once more, O my soul, for the Lord has been good to you.
For you,
a reading from the book of Exodus, chapter 20. And God spoke all these words, "I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol in the form of anything in heaven above, or on the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the fathers to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you, nor your son or daughter, nor your manservant or maidservant, nor your animals, nor the alien within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day, and he made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, so that you may live long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his manservant or maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. The word of the Lord.
Lord God, eternal and almighty Father, we acknowledge before your holy majesty that we are poor sinners, conceived and born in guilt and in corruption, prone to do evil, unable of our own power to do good. Because of our sin, we endlessly violate your holy commandments. But, O Lord, with heartfelt sorrow, we repent and turn away from all our offenses. We condemn ourselves and all our evil ways, with true sorrow, asking that your grace will relieve our distress. Have compassion on us, most gracious God, Father of mercies, for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And in removing our guilt, also grant us daily increase in the grace of your Holy Spirit, and produce in us the fruits of holiness and of righteousness, pleasing in your sight, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Of his great mercy, God has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn to him. May we know his forgiveness this night and be encouraged by these comforting words from Holy Scripture. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us.
Thank you.
You may be seated. A reading from the book of Exodus, chapter 12. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in Egypt, "This month is to be for you the first month of your year. Tell the whole community of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, each man is to take a lamb for his family, one for each household. If any household is too small for a whole lamb, they must share one with their nearest neighbor, having taken into account the number of people there are. You are to determine the amount of lamb needed in accordance with what each person will eat. This is how you are to eat it, with your cloak tucked into your belt, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. Eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. On that same night, I will pass through Egypt and strike down every firstborn, both men and animals, and I will bring judgment on all the gods of Egypt. I am the Lord. The blood will be a sign for you on the houses where you are, and when I see the blood, I will pass over you. No destructive plague will touch you when I strike Egypt. This is a day you are to commemorate. For the generations to come, you shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord, a lasting ordinance." The word of the Lord.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Corinthians, beginning in verse 23. "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. But if we judged ourselves, we would not come under judgment. When we are judged by the Lord, we are being disciplined, so that we will not be condemned with the world. So then, my brothers, when you come together to eat, wait for each other. If anyone is hungry, he should eat at home, so that when you meet together, it may not result in judgment. The word of the Lord.
This is the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death, he said to them. Stay here and keep watch. Going a little farther, he fell to the ground and prayed that, if possible, the hour might pass from him. Abba, Father, he said, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will. Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. Simon, he said to Peter, are you asleep? Could you not keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the body is weak. Once more, he went away and prayed the same thing. When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. They did not know what to say to him. Returning the third time, he said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? Enough. The hour has come. Look, the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer. This is the word of the Lord.
I want to welcome you all. So glad that you can join us from afar. It all feels quite off and wrong. This is supposed to be a service of communion, the evening in which the Lord gave his new command of love, to be together, and he wanted to fellowship with his beloved disciples whom he loved with all of his heart. And here we are with an empty auditorium. And as a pastor, and I think all the pastors feel this way, we feel brokenhearted because it is our desire to be with you. So just like there's something not quite right tonight, there was also something not quite right on that Thursday night long ago when Jesus, after finishing the meal, went to a place called Gethsemane. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, as we reflect on this scripture, we ask that you would open up our hearts to understand your love and that we would understand who you are. In your shadow, may we know ourselves. May we find ourselves. May we find your love. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, Gethsemane. Gethsemane is this place where it is the deep breath before the plunge. Our series on the Gospel of Mark has been titled On the Way, which has been a phrase that Mark uses throughout the text. Jesus on the way to the cross. And Gethsemane is the last stop before he goes. Gethsemane, it's an orchard. It's at the foot of the Mount of Olives, just outside the city of Jerusalem, and we're told by one of the other Gospels that it was a favored place by Jesus to go with his other disciples and to pray. Gethsemane, the word actually means olive press. Apparently it was an olive orchard, and perhaps other things were grown there as well, but it was olives mainly. And it was a place that olive oil was produced. I suppose it's ironic, but appropriately so that as the olives were taken, and typically they were put in a vat, a stone vat, and a stone circle wheel would be wheeled around, and the olives would be pressed, they would be crushed by the stone. And it is with some sense of irony that here in Gethsemane that Jesus is being intensely pressed, not by stones, but by the weight of evil on the one hand and by the will of the Father on the other. What will Jesus do here in Gethsemane? Gethsemane reveals the very difficult human decision confronting Jesus. It was a decision in which he had to make a choice all by himself. And it was a decision that would result in him becoming utterly alone. A lot of us feel alone. A lot of us feel a little bit heavy-hearted as we are dealing with isolation and being separated from one another. Jesus not only understood this, but Jesus experienced it exponentially much greater than any of us could imagine. Christ was alone in ways that we cannot even begin to understand. And I want to take a few moments with you and reflect on this passage in Mark chapter 14 that I believe describes at least three ways that Jesus was alone. First of all, Jesus was alone without companion. He was alone without companion. Of course, it didn't start off that way, did it? There was cheering, and he was famous. He was beloved by many, looked to, but it didn't end that way. At first, it was in Galilee where we see his family begin to abandon him, wanting to silence him. Then it was his village in chapter 6, but eventually that abandonment would spread. It would spread to both Jews and to Gentiles. It would spread to country folk and to city folk. Jesus partly made it happen. He pushed hard against the religious authorities. I imagine that they didn't want to do what they did to him, but he kept on pushing and pushing. The Pharisees, the Sadducees, the chief priests, the scribes, and the theologians, he kept on going after them, and he wouldn't let go. And then in chapter 11, when Jesus clears the temple, it seems to be that's the final straw. That's when all of them have made the final decision to terminate him, to get rid of him. But Jesus still had friends. 3 years he traveled with his companions, his disciples. They spent lots of time together, time with family. They ate so many meals, who knows how many meals they ate together. They traveled together. They had nicknames for one another. They were close, closer than we could imagine. And the disciples witnessed so much. The casting out of demons, the healings of so many, the power over nature, the multiplying of bread, and Jesus loved them. Jesus loved these disciples. Just a few hours before Jesus arrives in Gethsemane, he had washed his feet, the feet of the disciples. He gave them that new command to love one another as he has loved them. He instituted his love feast and even said to them in John 15, "No longer do I call you servants, for the servant does not know what his master is doing, but I have called you friends." And so Jesus goes to Gethsemane. It says in verse 33, he took with him Peter. He took the disciples, but then took with him closer, deeper into the garden, Peter and James and John, and he instructed them to stay with him and to watch. Why did Jesus bring them? Because he wanted friends. This was the hour of trial. In fact, Luke says this was the hour of the power of darkness. And Jesus desired to have his closest comrades to be with him, to be physically present with him. Because Jesus, like us, we're not designed to be alone. We're designed by God's creation to be social, to be with one another. I've always liked the words of Dietrich Bonhoeffer in his book, Life Together. He says, "The believer need not feel any shame when yearning for the physical presence of other Christians, as if one were still living too much in the flesh." Oh, no. The physical presence of other Christians is a source of incomparable joy and strength to the believer. And so we want to be with other Christians. We crave it. We want to be with our closest friends who understand us and know our ways, and we for them. And so Jesus, three times, he kept on pleading with them, watch and pray, watch and pray. But they slept. Maybe they ate too much food that night, who knows? But they were in clearly a spiritual stupor. One poet says, backwards and forwards, thrice he ran, as if he sought some help from man. And so Jesus, it was understandable that many others turned away from him. The religious leaders turned against him, ones I'm sure he held in high esteem, as he should. His family turned against him. His village turned against him. But here in this night, his very friends, they too forsook the Savior. As you know, one betrayed him. To betray is to actively work against the will of another. He sought to undermine the mission of Jesus. And then another denied Jesus. Just moments before, swearing up and down that he would never leave the Savior, that he would stand by him. But just a few moments after Gethsemane, in the wee hours of the night, even before a young slave girl, Peter, the top of his lungs, says, I swear to God that I don't know the man. And three times he denied him. And then all of his other friends, they deserted him. They went into the shadows, too concerned for their own skins to stay with him. Of course, we're actually told by the gospel that Jesus purposely had them removed, asked to have them taken away to safeguard them. We are told that in the Gospel of Luke that an angel appeared to Jesus to strengthen him, but not even the angel could stay for long. No, Jesus, on this night, in this place, became utterly alone without a companion. I wonder to myself, what would I have done? What would you have done? No doubt if we were there, we too would have left him. And yet, knowing what we would do, foreseeing it all in his divinity, he continued to hold out his friendship and his love to each one of us. An amazing Savior who was alone, alone without companions. A second way that Jesus was alone was that he was alone with this cup, says in verse 36. Verse 33, it says, he took with him Peter and James and John, and they began to be greatly distressed and troubled. This word, greatly distressed, it literally means astonished. Christ experienced these emotions. He was in shock. That's what the language actually means. He was troubled. There was such emotional anguish upon him as he came into the Garden of Gethsemane. He was overcome with some type of horror. I'm sure he experienced the tightness of chest and shortness of breath, and there was this uncontrolled weeping. There was a pit in his stomach. Perhaps the room, the space around him was swirling. Why was Christ so emphatically overwhelmed? What was the cause? It's not that he was afraid of dying. No, I don't think so. Nor is he clearly afraid of human rejection. Nor do I think he was afraid of physical pain, that the crucifixion was coming. But verse 36 tells us exactly the reason why. It was this cup It's this cup that he asked the Father to remove from him. It was this cup that horrified him. And if we did a study of this idea of the cup, well, I think probably the easiest verse that explains it all comes out of Psalm 75:8, but there are many other passages we can point to. Psalm 75:8 says, "For in the hand of the Lord is a cup with foaming wine, well mixed, and he pours out from it, and all the wicked of the earth shall drain it down to the dregs." It's the cup. What is this cup? It's the cup of the wrath of God. That is what is horrifying our Lord. Our perfect Lord, sinless in every way, one who had never known any sin, was now being asked to drink the cup. And what was in this cup? All of our sin, all of our wickedness and our wrongdoing was put into this cup. And he was going to drink it, metaphorically so. But not only was our sin in this cup, but God's wrath, because of the sin, was also in the cup. The wrath of God poured out, rather than on the wicked and the nations, poured out on our Lord Jesus Christ, in which he was to drink it down to the dregs. But not only was he to drink our sin and wrath, sin which he had never been present with, now was going to be with him. The wrath of God which he had never known would now be upon him. But not only so, but the presence of Abba Father. Abba Father, who he had been with from all eternity past, in perfect fellowship, in perfect union, this cup, in receiving his wrath, meant that the fellowship was broken, that he would no longer be in the presence of Abba, his Father. It was taken away. And it horrified him, and rightly so. None of us, of course, could even come to any understanding of what this fellowship would look like. The only thing that I can personally think of in my own experience has been my own father, who loves me and I love him. And I remember being in my late 20s when we were remodeling our home in a significant way, and we were in way over our heads on this project. It cost far too much money, and we had no idea what we were doing. And we were having all kinds of trouble with the inspectional services of the city. And I remember going around struggling with this work and thinking to myself, this city is, it's a dog-eat-dog world. And as I struggled, I remember having this thought. It was my dad. My dad. He had been there throughout all of this project. My dad was with me. My dad is going to stay by me. And that actually helped me. And it was true. That's exactly what he did. It was his presence that brought me comfort. But not so with an exponentially more amazing relationship between Jesus and his Father. Broken. Broken in ways that we could never dream or imagine or begin to understand. So, brothers and sisters, on this night, as he looked at this cup, he realized that he was alone, alone without companion. And as he would take on our sin as sin bearer, and as he would bear the wrath of God, he would be alone without his Father. A third way that Jesus was alone was that he was alone with a cast down soul. He was alone with a cast down soul. In verse 34, he says to Peter, James, and John, My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. And so we need to understand that as the Gospels talk about Jesus, they are, in this passage, we are particularly seeing that it is Jesus in his humanity that is just as important as Jesus in his divinity. He was not just God. He was also man. Man experiencing powerful emotions. And if you want to understand the Gospels, you must understand, as it's been classically talked about around words of Jesus, that he has two natures in one person. The two natures, that he has the nature of God and the nature of man. But one person without confusion or change or division or separation. And you won't understand the Gospels. You can't really read them and understand them in their detail unless you understand that Jesus is both simultaneously as one person, both God and man. But here we're really seeing the humanity of Jesus, his humanity. In fact, I think it is somewhat helpful to think of Gethsemane as a new Eden. You remember the Garden of Eden at the beginning of the Bible where Adam and Eve were. Gethsemane, at least it's being alluded to in the Gospels as an Eden in which Jesus is like the old Adam, but facing the new temptation. And the depiction, the question of this man, this new Adam, is would he pass the test? In the Gospel of John, we're told Gethsemane was a garden. And it's purposeful that he's describing it as a garden because it will immediately take our minds back to that other garden where there was another man in terrible turmoil. In fact, Luke talks about Jesus sweating like drops of blood, which I suppose is another allusion, a reminder of what would come out of Adam's sin, in which by the sweat of his brow he would have to do and work the land. So Jesus was human. He was this new Adam. And it was important and even essential that Jesus pass the test. Because it's not as if Jesus could just come and go to the cross and bear sin. Sometimes that's called the passive obedience of Jesus. But necessary also, just as important, was the life, his righteous life, in living out completely and perfectly the Ten Commandments, in obeying the will of God. And Gethsemane is the last moment, the last opportunity for him to fail. And I suppose it's the most pressing of all of the temptations as he faces the question of this cup. It's his righteousness in passing the test. It's this that is given to us through the cross, sometimes called the double imputation of the work of Jesus Christ, in which we take our sin, and on the cross it's given to him. But you see, his righteous, perfect life that he's lived, fulfilled even in this last moment at Gethsemane, it's that righteous life which is imputed to us, so that God, when he sees you and me, he counts us holy when we put our faith in Jesus Christ. His righteousness in obeying the will of God is imputed or counted to us. He says to the Father, "Take this cup from me." That's his prayer. "Lord, you can do anything. Please, please, if there's some other way, take this cup." And he cried with terrible emotion, from the pit of his stomach. This was not sin. This was the trial, in his last trial. And it's normal. It's normal that when we face the tension of what we want, and it comes into the confrontation of what God wants, when they're in tension with one another, we struggle. What is the human desire? What is the human will? Well, for every one of us, it's to flourish. We want to protect ourselves. It's right and good to want happiness and health and to seek meaning and purpose, to desire relationship and material and financial stability. These are all part of God's good creation. And it's by God's design that we desire them, that we will them. But you see, what's going on in Gethsemane is that natural right desire that Jesus has is now coming into full confrontation with the desire or the will of God. Powerful emotions, and then powerful thoughts. Perhaps he's thinking to himself, I don't deserve to die, which is true. He might ask the question, do they deserve my life? No, they don't. They don't even care about me, he might think, and that would be actually true. Perhaps he thinks to himself, isn't it more just if they die and I live? And yes, actually, that would be the more just thing. And then he finally, he asked, Lord, I want to accomplish your plan, but can there be some other way? And we don't hear an answer from heaven, but God's silence, at least in this case, would appear to be, no, there's no other way. This was the Father's will. In fact, when we look at Isaiah 53:10, it's very instructive. It's an important verse to Gethsemane. It says, it was the will of the Lord to crush him and to make, for him to make an offering for guilt. That was the will of the Father. And there could be no other way. It also says at the latter part of verse 10 of Isaiah 53, but then the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. So we see actually the will of the Father is twofold, both to crush him and to prosper him. But it comes with this sequence. First, Christ must be humiliated. He must suffer. And only thereafter would he be exalted. That is the path of flourishing. It's the way of suffering, the Via Dolorosa. So what will Jesus do? Verse 36. Abba, Father! What is his response? These amazing words, yet not what I will, but what you will. Yet not what I will, but what you will. The human will of Jesus, which naturally and rightly desired to prosper and flourish, was then brought into line with the will of the Father, with the divine will. Yet not what I will, but what you will. I will go this way if there can be no other way. It's the way of love. This sacrifice, this drinking of this cup. How does Jesus arrive there? How does he work through all of these incredibly powerful emotions to arrive so that his human will submits to the will of God? Well, he intensely prays. And when we are struggling with the will of God, we're called to intensely pray. He invited others to be with him. They weren't all that helpful. but we can invite others and perhaps we'll have better friends. He intensely prayed, but he had interpreted his own experience through Scripture. In fact, verse 34, where it says, "I am overwhelmed with sorrow," is an allusion, or at least or a direct reference to Psalm 42:5, which says, "Why are you cast down?" That word "cast down" is overwhelmed. It's the same word translated from Greek into Hebrew. "Why are you cast down, O my soul? Why are you in turmoil within me?" So as Jesus is in Gethsemane, it's Psalm 42, verse 5, and this repeating question of the turmoil of this cast down soul in which he's been left alone to ask this question to himself. But notice, he brings his very own experience within the lens and interpretation of Scripture, which is what we must also do as we struggle and wrestle to understand our path. We must constantly go to Scripture, searching for its right text to apply to our life, to show us the way. And he not only did this, but he also claimed God's promises, which is embedded within all of the Psalms, all but two Psalms of lament. There is always this pattern of lament, which is typically in the form of a question, and then a statement of hope. And we see this in Psalm 42:5. It's repeated three times in Psalm 42 and Psalm 43. "Why are you cast down, O my soul? Why are you in turmoil within me?" And then he speaks the promises of God to himself. "Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God." And so even in asking the question of turmoil, the psalmist then tells the soul, his own soul, to put faith in God, because "I will yet praise him." This future hope. And I believe that must have been what Jesus was doing in Gethsemane, as he cried with loud cries and many tears, "Why are you cast down, O my soul?" But then the promise is always there. So we have to claim the promise, especially when we're in a place like Gethsemane. "Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God." What did Jesus, even in recognizing that he had to drink the cup, and he did so voluntarily out of his own love for you and me, and out of love for the Father, he was able to remind himself that there was hope. There is always hope with God. "I will yet praise him," which is a statement of where he will be in the future. And so I would wonder if Jesus does exactly that. "I will yet praise him, though I drink this cup." And so he releases his will, his human will, into the will of the Father. "I will. It's what I want. It's what I desire." Bound up in our will is our identity, our hopes, our dreams of who we are and where we should go. It's good to have a will. It's fine to have a strong will. But ultimately, we must bow our wills and will what the Father wills, rather than what we will. My willing, my future, I lay myself before the Father. Can I ask you, what about you in this case? Perhaps you're experiencing some taste of Gethsemane in a relationship, perhaps at work, perhaps facing some illness. where your stomach is turned over and you feel desperate. If you put your hope in God, then you can begin to say, not what I will, but what you will. I encourage you to do that. Even if you don't feel it, you can say it. You can get down on your face and say, even in the midst of the turmoil and emotion, not my will, not what I will, but what you will. Try it. Encourage you to do it. Over that broken relationship, over that lost job or the job that just won't come your way, over the broken body, or whatever it is that you're tasting. And so Gethsemane is this somber reminder that Christ was alone. He was alone without companions. He was alone with this cup. And he was alone with these cast down emotions and soul. I was reminded of the amazing story of Johnny Erickson Tada. She preached here 9 years ago down on this platform. As a 17-year-old, she had a diving accident in which she jumped off a raft in the Chesapeake Bay, and she broke her neck, and she became a quadriplegic. Her life was utterly changed that day. She had become a Christian just a couple years before, but she says that she was mostly doing it because she thought God would help her. But then how could all of this happen? And Johnny went through turmoil in her own life without being able to use her arms and her legs, angry and desperate, doubting God, considering suicide. But then finally one day, she had this prayer. She said, God, if I cannot die, show me how to live. She said she woke up the next day and something began to change within her soul. I was recently just reading some of the things that she said. She said, Johnny says, trust in Christ is not having trustful feelings. Your emotions don't necessarily go with trust. But to trust is an act of the will. Your emotions will catch up. She says, I'd rather be in this chair knowing Christ than to be on my feet without him. And so we're called, friends, to release our wills into the will of the Father, and we can be sure that God will bring about good things if you would trust in him. Johnny Erickson Tada, she's also a singer and a good one. She wrote these words a few years ago in a song. She says, I'm alone, yet not alone. God's the light that will guide me home. With his love and tenderness, leading through the wilderness, and wherever I may roam, I'm alone, yet not alone. Lord Jesus, thank you that you made yourself utterly alone so that we never need to be. Fill us with faith as we so desperately need you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand together. You can stand where you are joining us tonight and confess our faith using these ancient words of the Nicene Creed. Christians, what do you believe? We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ,
the only begotten Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
As we continue to worship the Lord, we will invite you to stay seated or to kneel as we pray to him. Let us pray together. Lord Jesus, we come before you as your people, spread over many places, yet one in heart, one with you, and we know that you hear us no matter where we are. We pray that as we pray as your people, our prayers would cut through the skies and pierce your ears, and that you would hear us, because we're praying all of these things in the name of Jesus. So let us pray for the church, for the world, adding our own prayers silently after each of these biddings. Let us begin. Let us pray for the peace of the whole world and for the well-being and unity of the people of God. Let us pray for all the ministers and people of our congregation. Let us pray for the gospel to be proclaimed. And now let us remember those who don't know Jesus, and let's lift those people up before Jesus. Let us pray for those who work in the hospital, doctors and nurses, all the staff, those who are caring for the sick. Let us pray for their health and their strength. Let us pray for our sisters and brothers in Christ who are persecuted on behalf of their faith in Jesus. Let us pray for our nation, for our president, for all those in authority, for all those in public service. Let us pray for those who are in trouble, those who are in jail, those who are bereaved with great sorrow, those who are facing great adversity and illness. Finally, let us pray for revival across our land, that the Lord would use the events of this time to shake our hearts so that there would be a new awakening to who He is and all that Jesus has done. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, grant these our prayers for the sake of Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate, who lives and who reigns with you in unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And now, brothers and sisters, let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our coming day's bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into trial, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
At this time in the service, we would normally partake of the sacrament of the Lord's Supper together. This is, of course, the night that Jesus instituted this meal with his beloved disciples. And so the observance of the Lord's Supper is typically an integral part of this service of worship. In this irregular time, however, because we are not able to gather physically to partake in a shared meal, we are refraining from the sacrament. And this is certainly a loss and a disappointment to us all. But I want us to remember that even as we are bound to our homes, that Christ is not bound. The opportunity to know and to experience and to commune with Jesus has not diminished. He is present to us, his people, even as we cannot be present to one another. And this is our great need and desire, to have Christ. We depend upon him for life and for sustenance, for strength. As a meal, the sacrament of the Lord's Supper clearly communicates this to us. Just as our bodies desire and need regular nourishment to live, so too do we, in an even more essential way, need Christ to live. So tonight, in place of sharing the Lord's Supper, let us spend some time in silent prayer to express to Jesus our desire for him and our need for him. And to help us do that, I offer to you these words from the Psalms. Psalm 63:1. O God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you, as in a dry and weary land where there is no water. Psalm 42:1. As a deer pants for flowing streams, so pants my soul for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. And Psalm 73, verses 25 and 26, whom have I in heaven but you? And there is nothing on earth I desire besides you. My heart and my flesh may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. Let's take some time in silent prayer to express our longing for and our need for Jesus. And now let us pray together. Dear Jesus, we love you above all things, and we desire to possess you within our souls. And since we cannot now receive you sacramentally, we beseech you to come spiritually into our hearts. We unite ourselves to you, together with all your faithful people gathered in spirit, those scattered in body, and we embrace you with all the affections of our souls. Never permit us to be separated from you. Amen. After Jesus said this, he looked toward heaven and prayed, Father, the time has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. For you granted him authority over all people, that he might give eternal life to all those you have given him. Now this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I have brought you glory on earth by completing the work you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began. I have revealed you to those whom you gave me out of the world. They were yours. You gave them to me, and they have obeyed your word. Now they know that everything you have given me comes from you, for I gave them the words you gave me, and they accepted them. They knew with certainty that I came from you, and they believed that you sent me. I pray for them. I am not praying for the world, but for those you have given me, for they are yours. All I have is yours, and all you have is mine. And glory has come to me through them. I will remain in the world no longer, but they are still in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them by the power of your name, the name you gave me, so that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them and kept them safe by that name you gave me. None has been lost except the one doomed to destruction, so that Scripture would be fulfilled. I am coming to you now, but I say these things while I am still in the world, so that they may have the full measure of my joy within them. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, for they are not of the world any more than I am of the world. My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of it. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. For them, I sanctify myself, that they too may be truly sanctified. My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me. May they be brought to complete unity, to let the world know that you have sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am and to see my glory, the glory you have given me because you loved me before the creation of the world. Righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you, and they know that you have sent me. I have made you known to them and will continue to make you known in order that the love you have for me may be in them, and that I myself may be in them.